So we have reached the design procedure of double shoe brake. This is very much similar as that of the single shoe brake. There is only slight variation only in one particular step. All the other steps remains one of the same. Now let's see what is the speciality of double shoe brake. As I told that the first step is very much same. We are going to calculate the torque value. We can easily get the value of torque. We can calculate the value of Ft and we can calculate the value of mu dash if required. So these three steps remains one at the same. And one issue we have to understand here is that here in the step number two, there is a slight variation, because in the step number two, for single shoe brake, from the value of T, we were directly getting the value of Ft. But the problem with the double shoe brake is that you know that say double shoe brake is something like this. You have one shoe over here and another shoe over here. Suppose you are taking an anti-clockwise rotation, here the Ft is going to act like this and here the Ft is going to act like this. So here you have Ft1 and Ft2, Ft1 and Ft2. So here we are just getting an Ft and this is not the right Ft. If we want to relate something here, it is something like this. Here Ft1 plus Ft2 into D by 2 is going to be equal to torque. This is the relation that we are supposed to use here. So in the step number 2, you are not going to get the value of Ft1 or Ft2. Here you have only Ft1 plus Ft2 into D by 2 is equal to T. So here we are not going to get the value of Ft. But this is how the relation will look like. Okay, now let's move forward and see how it is being solved. And here the interesting fact is that, so say this is the example that I have selected here. And if I am going to take this as the first shoe and this is the second shoe. And if you take the first shoe, I can say that based upon the orientation of this fulcrum, figure C is going to give me the answer. And if I take the first shoe, I can say that based upon the clockwise rotation, Ft1 is going to act like this, which is away from the fulcrum point. So here the counterclockwise rotation is going to give the Ft1 acting away from the fulcrum point. So I will use the equation, counterclockwise equation. Here this is Ft1. So F will be equal to Ft1 B divided by A plus B into 1 by mu minus C by A. From this equation 13.17, this equation, you get the value of Ft1 in terms of F. This is what you have to do, right? Now if you take the second shoe here, if you take the second shoe, this is going to be the normal force Fn2, this is going to be the normal force Fn1, and here this is going to be the direction of Ft2, like this, look here, and it is towards the fulcrum point. So the clockwise direction is going to give you the Ft2 towards the fulcrum point. So you are going to take the clockwise rotation. Here also you get the value of Ft2 in terms of F. So here this Ft means Ft2. Here this Ft is Ft1. So if you take back all the terms to the left hand side, you can get the value of Ft2 in terms of F. Here Ft1 in terms of F. Now comes the most interesting part. Like I told, how will you relate is T is equal to Ft1 plus Ft2 into D by 2 is the relation that we have concluded in this step number 2. Here you substitute this equation 1 and 2. Then how it will look like? Something into F plus something into F into D by 2 is going to be T. You have the value of T, you have the value of D. The only unknown parameter is F. You can calculate the value of F. So this is the only step where we have got some change when compared with the single shoe brake. So in the single shoe brake, you just follow all the other steps in this thing. The remaining step also are one of the same. Here you have to design two shoes separately. That is the only thing. We are supposed to design two shoes, shoe number 1 and shoe number 2 separately, considering the force FT1 and FT2. Here we have to design two levers also. That is the only change. Right? So, this is the only change. FT1 and FT2 are not directly obtainable from the step number 2. So, in the step number 4, you have to get the value of FT1 and FT2 in terms of the actuated force and back substitute that equation, get the answer. So, that is how you have to do it. And followed by this, we have to design the shoe, all the conventional steps. And followed by that, you have to design the lever and finally the heat generator. So, that concludes the design of the double shoe brake. So, this is how you complete the design procedure of double shoe brake. Only a slight variation. If you notice this, if you understand the slight variation, it is easy. If it is not, you are going to get confused. Okay, so just understand the step number 2 and 4, how you are going to use those two steps and extract the value of FT1 and FT2. Thank you.